do me a favor and don't move for at least 5 seconds. Oh, you just lost. You totally moved to right there for a bit. No, I didn't. You did. Hi, I'm Thyme, and I am standing still. In other words, I have zero motion. In physics, motion is the change in position or orientation of an object with time and with respect to a frame of reference. Let's save that last part for later in the video. Right now, I'm not moving. Now, I'm changing position or translating. And now, I'm changing orientation or rotating. These are the two ways any object can move, and any movement is described by how fast they're moving and in what direction. A common quantity for how fast something is going is the speed, and the SI unit is meters per second. Speed is simply distance traveled over time taken. You move from kilometer 5 to kilometer 15 on the highway in 10 minutes, that means your car is going 10 kilometers every 10 minutes, or 16 kilometers an hour, or 16.67 meters a second. The graphs for position over time and speed over time would look something like this. Anyway, the car's speed may have fluctuated over these 10 minutes, so it's most probably the average speed. Believe it or not, there's almost no perfectly consistent movement that any object can make. There'll always be fluctuations of some kind, mostly due to environmental factors, and they're not always negligible. That means that this number isn't representative of the car's speed at every specific moment during its travel. To find its speed at a specific moment in time, otherwise called its instantaneous speed, you can narrow down the time period you use in the formula by as much as possible, as long as you know where the car was at the beginning and at the end of this period. Now, another quantity that's often preferable to speed is the velocity, which is defined by the displacement over time taken. That sounds just like speed, so what's the difference? Velocity takes into account the direction of movement, and speed doesn't. A car with a velocity of 20 meters per second that turns around would then have a velocity of minus 20 meters per second. Its speed, however, would remain 20 meters per second. Speed, like your speedometer, doesn't care where you're going, only how fast, so there's usually no point in having a negative value. We refer to quantities like these as scalar, and the quantities that are dependent on direction, like velocity, as vector. Let's take a moment to talk about scalars and vectors. Scalars are fully described by magnitude alone. These include quantities like distance, time, density, temperature, energy, and more. No matter which direction you're facing, their quantity would remain the same. But time, why do people still use negative signs with them then? Like minus 20 degrees Celsius, or minus 5 seconds? Well, unlike velocity, the sign here does not indicate direction. An object that's minus 20 degrees Celsius doesn't mean that it's facing opposite to an object that's 20 degrees Celsius, because these quantities don't depend on the physical orientation or position of the object they're describing. Minus 20 degrees Celsius is also 253.15 Kelvin, an absolute measurement in temperature, and yet, that doesn't have a negative in it. In another case, minus 5 seconds just means taking 5 seconds away from something, because although time is often associated with movement, it is not, in and of itself, dependent on something's physical position or orientation. Now, a vector, on the other hand, does depend on the direction of the object it's describing. Vectors include quantities like displacement, velocity, force, momentum, weight, and more. Sometimes an arrow is put over a symbol to indicate that it's a vector. These quantities may be negative or positive simply by having the object they're describing face different directions. A person running at 3 meters a second is heading the exact opposite way of someone running at minus 3 meters a second. But time, what if you run diagonally? Good catch! This vector quantity only describes the direction in one dimension. For example, positive for right and negative for left, or up and down, or forward and backward. If you were to move up and right simultaneously, aka in two dimensions, you need two of these quantities to describe your direction. In three dimensions, you need three. Four in four dimensions, and so on. This person moving 20 meters a second diagonally, for instance, or in 45 degrees, is really just moving 14.14 meters a second to the right and 14.14 meters per second up. Thus, you describe his velocity as 14.14 meters a second in the x direction, or horizontally, and 14.14 meters a second in the y direction, or vertically. If it's to the upper left, the x becomes negative. Lower right, the y becomes negative. And lower left, both are negative. We'll discuss vector calculation some other time, but you get the idea for now. If you've been paying attention, you'd notice that I said distance was a scalar and displacement was a vector. Aren't they the same thing? Well, evidently not. Distance, used in speed, is a measure of how much ground you've covered in a certain time period. It pays little respect to where you began or where you ended up. Displacement, used in velocity, is the other way around. It's the difference in position between where you began and where you ended up in a certain time period. It doesn't care how much ground you've covered, only how far you ended up from where you started and in which direction. Now, the moment you multiply any amount of scalar with a vector, the result will always be a vector. That's how it works. Time is a scalar, but displacement is a vector. So, velocity is a vector. Distance, however, isn't a vector, so neither is speed. Simple enough, yeah? Why use speed at all then? It's because sometimes you wouldn't care where an object is going, only how fast. When you're calculating your fuel consumption, you care about how much distance your car has traveled, not its displacement. And so, your rate of fuel consumption is tied to the car's speed and not necessarily its velocity. On the other hand, your mom waiting for you to get home doesn't care if you take the long route or the short route, only that you go from where you were to home in a certain amount of time. Hence, displacement, and hence, velocity. In science, however, velocity is generally preferable since the direction of movement is almost always relevant, and it never really hurts to have that information even if you don't end up using it. Oh, and also, in physics, you very often use an object's instantaneous velocity, and an object's instantaneous velocity is extremely similar to their instantaneous speed. This is because the narrower the time period you use, the less movement you're accounting for, and the more the distance and displacement resemble each other to the point where it's pretty much the same. Okay, we've been talking about the rate at which displacement changes, which is velocity, and next, the rate at which velocity changes, which is acceleration. Acceleration is change in velocity over a period of time. Its unit is meters a second squared, and it's also a vector. Let's add acceleration over time to displacement and velocity graphs like what we did earlier. In this case, the velocity is constant at 40 meters a second, so the distance keeps increasing by 40 meters each second. The acceleration is zero, so the velocity doesn't change. Now, if you make it so that the car accelerates at minus 5 meters a second squared, or decelerates, I guess, the car needs 8 seconds to come to a stop, and the graphs would now look like this. Take a moment to let that in, because that's pretty much it for the topic. Just to recap, here are the formulas, and here are some example quantities for scalar and vector. Here, the triangle symbol is a Greek capital letter delta, and in math, it's used to denote change. Delta V simply means change in V, or V final minus V initial. It's not necessary to use this, but sometimes not having delta implies that it's an absolute measurement, as in V initial is zero. In reality, V initial isn't always zero, since you can take any point in time when the car is already moving. This applies to all quantities, not just velocity. One last thing you should be aware of is the frame of reference. A frame of reference is an abstract coordinate system specified by a set of reference points. Now, if you're not caught up to your math, it's essentially the coordinate system that you base a particular movement on. a car going 20 kilometers an hour to the right is actually 20 kilometers an hour relative to Earth, or you if you're standing still. The Earth, in this case, is the frame of reference. If you're in a car going 5 kilometers an hour in the same direction, the car would still be 20 kilometers an hour relative to the Earth, but only 15 kilometers an hour relative to you. This is important because in reality, the Earth isn't staying still. It's rotating and revolving around the Sun. The Sun is revolving around the center of the Milky Way, and the Milky Way is moving in its cluster to who knows where. There isn't really a super reliable and absolute frame of reference to base every movement on. Neither is it a good idea. The universe is constantly expanding, and everything is moving all the time. It's just that most of the time, we don't care how fast the Earth is moving. Not only are they difficult to measure, it often doesn't matter because all we want to know is how fast the car is for us, standing here on the surface of the Earth. Movement is always contextual. In a way, planets don't orbit around the star, but they orbit around each other. A plane flying overhead is moving pretty fast for someone on the ground just as much as the ground is moving for someone on the plane. Whoever is standing still is up for you to decide. Movement depends on who's asking, or where and how you choose to observe them. The math is simple. Let's disregard sophisticated vector calculations or the theory of relativity for now. Two ships move toward each other into a head-on collision. To a neutral observer, on the ground, the first ship moves 37 kilometers an hour, the second 20 kilometers an hour. If you're on the first ship, how fast is the second ship moving towards you? And if there's 10 kilometers between you, how fast until you collide? In this case, you're using the first ship as your moving frame of reference, since you're standing on it. Because you're moving towards each other, the second ship will seem like it's moving faster than it actually is for someone on the ground. For you, it's moving at 37 plus 20 kilometers an hour, or 57 kilometers an hour. If there's 10 kilometers between you, it'll take about 0.175 hours for them to hit you, or about 10.5 minutes. If the second ship is moving away from you, it'll be moving at 37 minus 20, or 17 kilometers an hour, and it'll take about 35 minutes to reach. In this case, the reference frame of the first ship is something called the relative reference frame, and for someone on the ground who sees both ships for their actual surface speed, it's called the absolute reference frame. Of course, it'd be more complicated if rotation is taken into account and things are moving at inconsistent speeds and directions. Also, according to relativity, the faster you are or the closer you are to the speed of light, the more you experience time differently. That's a whole other can of worms though. For now, I think you've nailed the subject already. Feel free to rewatch the video if you're still confused, or ask in the comment section down below. Thank you for watching, everyone. I really appreciate it. Do like if you like it, dislike it if you don't. Subscribe if you want to see the continuation of these series and other stuff I'll be trying out. My next video would be a bit different, so look forward to that. See you next time.